In an interview with the New Indian Express, P.V. Ramesh, a physician turned bureaucrat, explains how the COVID-19 pandemic would change the way the civilization would behave for months or years to come, and how the concerted effort of the government in the last 10 months in strengthening the public health deliveries helped in stabilizing the situation in Andhra Pradesh.
See, I mean, of course, I mean, the government of India has a certain responsibility because many of these, number one, this availability. So the country's capacity to produce many of them is limited. Test kits, for example, we necessarily will have to import them. Only now certain domestic production is starting, but we yet to reach a certain threshold. So essentially, we will have to import much of this from other countries. Second is maintenance of quality. You know, I can wear, you know, I can use anything and call it a personal protection equipment. But it has to be of specific thickness, specific standard, specific design, so that I don't taint the others. The virus doesn't get in, virus doesn't get out. So these standards have to be rigorously maintained and monitored. So one centralizing agency is in a better position to procure globally supplies from across the globe, particularly when the entire globe is trying to source materials from the same and few available sources. It becomes, I mean, you know, it's always helps to have much, you have a price advantage, you have also a diplomatic outreach. So there are a number of advantages in the central government procuring. But the downside of that is delayed procurement, number one. Number two, I may not have adequate number, because again, in the large supplies means small deliveries. And the third is that centralization always leads to delay in supply. So there's delay issues, but the quality may be maintained. So these are difficult questions, but we in the state government will bank on both. We have already placed orders. I mean, we have taken advanced action to order for every equipment that we require. Now we are working through various channels also to get delivery of them. Now that the advisory has come from Government of India, we will weigh all our options.
Okay.
I think the village volunteers, ward volunteers, the village secretariats, I think they have done a splendid work. They need to be congratulated, along with the health professionals, health functionaries, police officers and the policemen on the field, revenue officers, and virtually every single government employee. I mean, if you really see today in a state of 5.2 crore people, the real machinery that is working is the government machinery, apart from the media, of course. And so otherwise, it's really the government machinery that is all over the place. So we need to congratulate them. But particularly and specially appreciable, and those who deserve kudos and congratulations, are the village and ward volunteers. I mean, they have done a phenomenal work in terms of going from home to home to trace the foreign returnees, to Delhi returnees, and conduct a surveillance of early symptoms, onset symptoms, and also in terms of delivering services to people, whether it is essential commodities, whether it is the pensions, whether it is the 1,000 rupees to family, all these have been delivered. And so in rural areas, they have done a much, much more effective job. In urban areas, it may be a little difficult. I mean, you've seen yourself how difficult it is to come to an apartment like this. And, you know, a volunteer to come up would be a much bigger problem. So urban areas, so that is why we have devised a distinct strategy for urban areas and a very different strategy for rural areas. In rural areas, we are largely dependent on the village-based workforce, that is the ASHA workers, and the more than 40,000 ASHA workers, 23,000 nurses, and the village volunteers, nearly more than 2 lakhs of them, and supported by this primary health center doctors, about 1,863 of them. So you have a big team of people who are working at the grassroots in villages. In the urban areas, we have adopted a slightly different model. We have pooled all the migrant labor, beggars, homeless, into these service centers, where we are feeding them, housing them, providing boarding, lodging, and you know, every support. And then the slum areas, we have really roped in a large number of MECMA group members, the social organizers, the resource person for a group of households, surveillance, monitoring. And then there is every ward we have placed a medical officer who can respond in terms of need. And then non-slum areas like this, we have given actually a self-reporting system. So you report yourself through app, through WhatsApp, you know, things like that, so that you can reach out to 104-1902 numbers. So that can be early identification of your problem to be taken to the hospital. Actually, I've always, these are not necessarily the views of Andhra Pradesh government or my chief minister, but certainly these are my views as a public health professional, I mean, who's practiced the trade for a long time, is that India is really does not have a robust public health system. We don't have a public health cadre. Why don't we have? Because we have set up this system. We've never really thought through what type of health system that country. I mean, the country has had, from starting from Bor Committee, which was set up during the pre-independence time, to now when hundreds of expert committees have been set up and they have made extraordinary recommendations, but there has always been a problem in terms of implementing them. There have been a problem of human resources, not enough doctors, not enough nurses, not enough paramedical workers, not enough money to build this hospital. So consequently, we have not really created this effective system. The second is, a doctor is trained to treat a disease. A surgeon is trained to do surgery. A ophthalmologist is trained to treat diseases of the eye. So there is a specialization. Whereas a public health is a much more integrated, much more comprehensive, and much broader discipline. This includes not just providing healthcare, that comes actually later, because that can always be provided by physicians. What public health really entails is that how does the disease start and spread, whether it is a communicable disease like COVID or non-communicable disease like diabetes, which is not, I cannot pass on diabetes to you. So this sort of these understanding. And then there is a sociological dimension behind this. Now, we are witnessing that in the United States, the minorities are dying in larger numbers. I mean, this could happen anywhere, that more people living in slums are under greater threat of this disease rather than those living in upmarket, better off places, because there are, people are densely packed together. If one person gets, the entire family gets the infection. So we have to see that the public health is intricately related, integrated with sociology, economics, the epidemiology. So this is a much more, so the relationship between the society and the societal dynamics and the politics, the policies, all this together make the public health. Now, so what in our system, what happens is, if I'm a professor of surgery, I only do surgeries all my life. I teach surgeries all my life. And then I suddenly become a director of public health. And then similarly, an IAS officer who's been hitherto managing industries suddenly comes as a secretary of health. Or even a doctor IAS officer, turned IAS officer, need not necessarily have this public health tools that are so critical. And so this is not peculiar to Andhra. It is true of entire country, barring few states, maybe Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Goa, they form an exception. Others don't have a public health care. So consequently, the doctors who run the public health system, and their understanding of epidemiology in a way is limited. And so what India requires is, number one, a public health cadre. Number two is well-trained public health professionals. Number three, public health policy professionals, that is those who run the health department at the secretariat level. You need to train some of the IAS officers and whoever other officers to really take up higher positions in the health hierarchy, managerial positions, so that they understand not just managing money and men and materials, but really this larger universe of health system. No other discipline, no other discipline, no other department touches every single human being's life. Everyone needs some medical attention or other. If not, you never need to go to hospital. Preventing disease is also part of the health system. So that is why I feel that we need a public health cadre, we need public health professionals, we also need more infectious disease experts, because we need more virologists, we need much stronger virology lab. That's not for today, but for tomorrow or for next month or next pandemic, if at all it appears. And then more importantly, India does not have an urban health system. In fact, in the urban areas are the most vulnerable. In fact, I've always worried in my entire career, from my early time as sub-collector, as how would India deal with an epidemic, because we never imagined a pandemic of this nature would happen, notwithstanding what Mr. Bill Gates said a few years ago on TED Talk. We didn't really expect, but I always worried about a cholera breaking out or a viral epidemic breaking out in a town, and where is the health system to manage that? I think we right now are better placed, Andhra Pradesh, with the with the urban MECMA groups, yes, it's self-help groups and their social organizers and the ward volunteers. But that is not enough. You really need a similar health system in the urban areas. And particularly urban areas have both communicable diseases like tuberculosis and diarrhea, respiratory infections, and also it has non-communicable diseases like hypertension, diabetes. So when you put them all together, you need a much, much stronger health system that you can call up on a lighter vein. So some of us at the upper end and the lower end are likely to get left out from the health system, because we assume that I can call up the managing director of Apollo Hospital or director of health or special chief secretary health, and then he would send some better off thing. So, but that's not enough. Every citizen must feel that he or she is protected. And Aarogyashri certainly works in that direction. But, even that is still not enough in emergencies of this nature. Coronavirus is just 3 months old baby, though it is killing many people. So if 3 months, we have to learn many more things about this baby and how wild it is, how virulent it is, and how bad it is, and how it behaves. So a lot of things that still we need to learn. So we don't know. Normally in pandemics of this nature, like Spanish flu, it killed many people. But the issue was these viral fevers, viral infections really were contained after polio, for example, smallpox. These are all viral infections that were really contained, controlled and eliminated only after a vaccine was introduced. Now, again, every virus behavioral dynamics are different, like flu, for example. There is a vaccine, but that vaccine effectiveness is only 60% of people are protected, and also protected for 6 months to 10 months. It's not lifelong. So there are some viruses in which there is a lifelong immunity. In some viruses, there is a short-term immunity. So we don't know what this has, a long-term or short-term immunity. So all we can hope for is this virus behaves like any other virus, that it will outlive its own existence, and then there will be a vaccine soon. In 12 to 16 months is what it takes for a vaccine to be developed. Maybe given the urgency, it could come even as early as 12 months, which is early next year. So hopefully that vaccine will be effective in preventing further diseases. All of us will take a vaccine, and maybe we will all be fine after that. Always hope for the best, but always be prepared for the worst. And that is true of the governments at large, and that's also true of the individuals. Hope for the best. I live to be 200 years old, but you know, yet be prepared that any one of us can contract COVID and fall seriously ill any time. So no one is immune. So we have to be prepared for the worst always. So perhaps this disease may die out very soon, and you know, we'll forget, and you know, you will stop interviewing people like me.